Across the state of Maine, medical practices are beginning to change healthcare for the better by striving to achieve what's called the triple aim.
The triple aim has three components. The first is to focus on population health. We have to move our thinking from how do I intersect with someone on a one-to-one basis to start to think about our healthcare, thinking about both people, groups of people in communities, and populations of people. The second principle is trying to improve the patient's experience of care. And I think what this does is challenge the provider community to say, I ought to know what's good science, what's good medicine, and what's the evidence base to do what I need to do as a provider giving high quality care. But how do I make sure that the patient understands, first of all, this is the right thing, and how do I pay attention to the other things that may impede or enhance their capacity to improve their health, and how do I listen and absorb that information? And the last principle is to lower the per capita cost of health care. We ought to be the most healthy nation with the most healthy people, and that ought to be what we aspire to. And we ought to do it at an affordable cost so that everyone's cared for in the system and everyone gets the care that you and I want to have. Those are the three simple principles of the triple aim. And I think they're achievable, particularly in Maine.
Here's a brief glimpse of just three of the many innovations that Maine practices are using today with the triple aim in mind.
We have had a patient advisory council for a couple years now, and I definitely see how it changes the culture in the practice and the way we look at things. For example, when we were interviewing for a new provider, one of our front office staff said, "Stephanie, have you thought about having one of our patients sit on the interview team?" And I thought, what a great idea, and I love watching and being a participant of those interviews with the patient interviewing a prospective doctor.
It communicates to the new applicant that patients are very important. They have a very crucial role in this practice. The people that apply for this kind of a practice, they're not put off by that, I don't believe, but I think they're surprised, pleasantly surprised that patients are so involved in the process right from the beginning of selecting applicants.
When you have a council, suddenly in day-to-day meetings or things we're doing in the practice, it's now more automatic to think we should ask our patient counsel about this. And when we do, they have fabulous advice that we would not have thought about.
The Saucapee Valley Health Center in Porter also has a very active patient advisory board. Joe Vaughn is a member.
I wanted to help too, you know, and I figured I could bring some good ideas to the table, and they listen to you and they do it. Because like the waiting room, they had a problem with like all the different diseases and whatnot, and they got pamphlets on them. They were like all scattered about, and I came up with the idea of, well, why don't we have one area where there's a desk and all the pamphlets all together in one area. And within a month it was like that. And I was just amazed, you know, to come in and say, wow, I was a part of that. That was a good feeling.
It's become really just part of the culture here. So when we're doing new things or thinking about starting new programs, people come to me and they're like, oh, can you bring this to the council? Can you get their input on that? So they've really become a tool for us to improve the services that we're providing.
As we move forward in healthcare reform, I think one of the most important things for providers and healthcare teams, as well as the patients, is the being able to use technology to really help all of us.
Using telehealth technology, the DFD Russell Health Center in Leeds is improving care by providing patients access to Dr. Ed Pontius, a psychiatrist at Sweetser in Brunswick.
Previously, the patients had been had needed to be referred from here to another office requiring travel to Lewiston, Auburn, or sometimes further places away, which made it very difficult for them. Now, with us being able to do the telepsychiatry appointments, they're able to come here to the office, which is closer to home. So they don't have to travel so far, they don't have to worry about the money, and a lot of times there's not as long of a wait for their appointments with Dr. Pontius. A lot of the area providers or psychiatrists, it's taking sometimes months for them to get in, and we can usually have a new patient in within a few weeks to see Dr. Pontius.
One of the things that you see is that within a few minutes, it seems the patient and I forget about the fact that there's miles and miles between us. The technology sort of fades out of view, and what there is me talking with a patient, very much like when I'm talking with a patient in a face-to-face interview.
With the easier availability with Dr. Pontius, we're avoiding a lot of the emergency room visits, the hospital admissions, and then they're having the follow-up visits with their primary care, but it's based on the recommendations that Dr. Pontius gives. So it's coordinating their care, it's managing their medications, following up and seeing how the medication is working, and then if things aren't working, they're scheduled again to see Dr. Pontius, and he recommends adjustments to be made.
And the Helen Hunt Health Center in Old Town is using technology to improve access to health records.
What we've done is look at partnering with our local hospitals to make sure that we're communicating better, for one. And this takes the form of improved access to records. So we have discharge summaries that we get now in real time. We often get phone calls from the local hospitalist taking care of our patients. So that's all improved communication, which improves patient care. But it also saves costs, because the patient is less likely to have unnecessary medications, unnecessary retesting, because I know exactly what they need. And when they come to see me for follow-up, if I need access to those tests or reports, I can actually often get them through the health infonet system, which allows me to log in and see what tests they've had done and get those reports.
10 practices in Maine are now piloting community care teams, staffed by nurses, social workers, and other professionals who travel beyond the practice walls to serve the most complex and high needs patients.
I think CCT fills a void in the healthcare system where patients that aren't homebound and don't have a skilled need weren't getting the home care that we needed, and we in primary care felt like, how can we really reach out and impact these patients that are the most needy? CCT allows us to have and see these patients and help us, you know, figure out exactly what's going on at home.
138 over 56.
These are people a lot of times who have been in the hospital a lot or in the emergency department a lot. They might have multiple chronic diseases. They might have a very complex medication regimen.
It's very enlightening to go into a patient's home and find out perhaps you can't get in there because it's so jam full of stuff. There's no place for them to put their CPAP machine. That's not something I can solve in my office visit, but the community care team has a very respectful and dignified way of getting to the bottom of those sorts of problems. And then looking at resources in the community. That's nothing that's going to be fixed with a prescription on my end. That's going to be, let's plug you in with Meals for Me. Let's go to Eastern Agency on Aging and see what resources might be available in your community.
It's really getting the patient involved and seeing that they do have the responsibility for their own health.
I was just saying today to another worker here at CHANS that I think that we already probably saved the salary of our CCT team, in that the patients that we were going over today in our group meeting, we probably saved 3 or 4 admissions I could see right now, and that would easily cover the cost of the CCT team, and it's just going to grow from there. So I see that this is no doubt going to save money in the health system.
It's great. It's a good service. It's a good service. Who's ever doing funding this is doing a great thing.
The one thing about Maine is that people working on healthcare, providers, health systems, payers, employers, advocates, consumer representatives, patients themselves, we know how to work together well in Maine. We may not have all the same ideas about how to achieve the transformation of healthcare, But we all know it needs to happen, and we're all willing to work together to really move healthcare to achieve the three goals of the triple aim.